chapter division between Philippians 1 and Philippians 2 is really kind of an unfortunate division, because the beginning of chapter 2 is just a continuation of the end of chapter 1, as Paul shifts from a discussion of external unity to internal unity. This is a really straightforward passage of scripture, so let's take a look at this in three sections, and we'll begin here in verse 1, where Paul makes several of these if statements in a row. He writes, "If then there is any encouragement in Christ, if any consolation of love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any affection and mercy." Now, these if statements are really more accurately since or because statements. These aren't really questions that Paul is asking. These are certainties. Encouragement in Christ, consolation of love, fellowship with the Spirit, affection and mercy. These are things that Paul is certain of. So these aren't if questions, really. These are since there are or because there are statements. It's not really clear in a lot of places exactly what Paul is referring to. For example, here, if any consolation of love, there's a lot of question of what kind of love does Paul mean? Does he mean God's love for the Philippians? Does he mean his own love for the Philippians? Does he mean the Philippians' love for one another? There's a lot that's not made very clear here, but this is really on purpose. This section is meant to be less of an exhaustive rational argument and more of a poetic and passionate exhortation to set up Paul's real point of emphasis, which is unity. So here he's just pleading with the Philippian church, because these things exist. Then he goes on, "Make my joy complete by thinking the same thing, having the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose." Now, this section gives us a key theme of unity. He's encouraging the Philippian church, pleading with them to be united. He wants them to have what Silva calls spiritual oneness. This is that internal unity that Paul has now turned his attention to. This unity should be a hallmark of the Christian church and the body of Christ. Unfortunately, it is beginning to fracture in the Philippian church, likely as a result of the opposition that they're facing, combined with just human nature. Some of this unity is beginning to fracture, as we'll see even a little more explicitly later in this book. And so Paul is reminding the church here of the importance of internal unity in Christ. And so he names four things in this call to unity here: thinking the same way, having the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. And these aren't really meant to be four different things. These are really meant to be repetitions of the same thing. They each support the other, and they're all repetitions of, again, Paul's call to unity. Now, this phrase, thinking the same way, and this one, the CSB renders intent on one purpose, these are really similar. Other translations, intent on one purpose, write this as being of one mind or being of the same mind. So these two are really very similar, and they are then supported by these in the middle, having the same love and united in spirit. And so what Paul is calling for here, again, is a mindset of unity based on their connection in Christ. Paul is not calling for them or for us to think the same way on every issue. He says thinking the same way, but he's not calling for us to think the same way on every issue. He's not calling for uniformity of thought, obviously. That's never going to happen with human nature. But he is calling for a mindset of unity in Christ, loving and being united in all manner of circumstance, good or bad, even if we find ourselves maybe on opposite sides of an issue, or maybe beginning to face some opposition that's drawing out some differences of opinion among us. We remain united in the same love, united in the same spirit of Christ. And I think this is a good application point for us here, and a good point for us to ask of ourselves. Do our actions toward the body of Christ, do our actions toward other believers, do our actions toward people in general encourage unity or disunity? The problem is, we live in a world that is constantly, it seems, divided. And spend a little time on social media if you don't believe me. we in our country, we divide over political party, we divide over race, we divide over things like how we should respond to a pandemic, and we divide along very sharp lines most of the time. Churches divide over everything from reformed theology to the style of music to simply, I don't like that person. And again, churches can divide over very sharp lines, even within the body of Christ. Now, again, we're not always going to think the same way or have the same opinions or land on the same side on these issues. But the question for us is, do our words and our actions, do the things that we post on social media, do they encourage unity or disunity? This doesn't mean that we have to agree on everything. It does mean that as believers united in Christ, we should engage in differences, we should engage in opposition as one body, unselfishly and with humility. Silva, in his same commentary on Philippians, writes, "The true obstacle to unity is not the presence of legitimate differences of opinion, but self-centeredness. Shifting attention away from ourselves becomes the challenge." Do your actions and words and thoughts contribute to unity or to disunity? And then in verses 3 and 4, Paul gives really the key to unity. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility consider others as more important than yourselves. Everyone should look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. And the unmistakable theme here then is humility. And Paul explains here that the key to internal unity is humility. Paul lays out here some very clear statements on what that humility looks like, and he does it through negative and then positive statements. So we have a couple of negative statements where Paul writes, for example, do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit. He also writes that everyone should not only look out for his own interest. Paul follows those negative statements up with positive ones of what we should do. In humility, he says we should consider others as more important than ourselves. And he also writes that we should not only look out for our own interest, but we should also look out for the interest of others. And all of these things lead to humility. We avoid selfish ambition and conceit. We avoid only looking out for ourselves. We begin to consider others as more important than ourselves and to consider their interests as more important than our own, to look out for those as well. This is Paul's definition of humility. And this fits in with another definition of humility that I've always liked, that says humility is not thinking less of yourself. Humility is thinking of yourself less. And I think here as well is a very good application point for us to consider. We talked earlier about unity versus disunity. The question here that this leads us to as we look at Paul's definition of biblical humility is, do we seek to live in this humility? Or do we find ourselves living out of selfish ambition and conceit and seeking only our own interest? For a couple of examples, we've been trained to think that our opinions are the only ones that matter and that anyone who disagrees with us is wrong. And often we act as though that person who is wrong should be attacked and shamed and abused until they come to our side, come to their senses, or flee the conversation. Do we contribute to that culture of selfish ambition and conceit when it comes to our opinions? Or do we seek to live in humility, trying to hear and understand someone on the other side of the divide? Do we seek to show grace and mercy to someone that we disagree with as a Christ follower? Again, I think it's fair to ask, since so many of us spend so much time there, what would your social media indicate? What would my social media indicate? That I'm more interested in living in humility and grace, or more interested in convincing others that I'm right? What about the areas in which we serve? Whether it's in church or at our place of business or even in our homes. How do we serve? How do you serve? Do you seek fame and recognition for the service that you contribute, or do you serve in humility? Humility is the key to unity. These two things are connected. And so let us seek to always live in humility and to always be in pursuit of unity in the body of Christ.